Good evening and welcome to our live YouTube and Facebook Wednesday conversation. I see that my Aunt Tammy said hey already, so hey there to you. If you're in here, go ahead and say hey. I'll make sure that I can see you pop up in the chat here. And we're just going to do our best to go through prayer requests and stuff like that. But first, I want to say I'm so glad you joined us. And I have a couple of things I want to remind you about. Hey there, Pam. Good to know that you're watching. Hi, Angie. I may not say hi to everyone, but I can now see that it's working. And you can hear me talking back to you. This is cool. It's working out the way we hope. First thing I want to remind you about is that Dwayne is on vacation. So if you need anything, I'll be glad to help any way that I can. All you need to do is call the church, because if you call the church phone number right now, I'll check the messages quickly. Or if you have my cell phone, give me a call. Let me know what I might be able to help you with, what I can be praying with you about, and anything I can do just to help you, or anything that really I can do to be a good Christian leader and help you in this time. The other thing that I'm sure you figured out by now by me saying your names that I wanted you to know is this is live. So what you're seeing right now is not pre-recorded and starting at 7. What you're seeing right now, live. We're starting to get a good rhythm with the live stream, and that's largely in part to help. So I'm going to show you two guys right here. One of them may not actually look at you, and I'm okay with it. But these two guys have been helping me, James and Peyton. I appreciate them, and they've been a huge help. So be sure you thank them for helping. And now that our live stream is going well, even if you're not comfortable coming back into the building on June 7th, back in here together to work together, you'll be able to watch it live stream as at home, see everything that's going on. And we understand the decision to stay home. We understand being cautious, but we wanted to make it possible to worship at home and still see what's going on from your home. And by the way, fellas, a bunch of people, thank you. I'm still saying. So with all this going on and all the new live stuff working, it has taken extra hands, but I think it was necessary for us to be able to allow everyone to be able to work. Fantastic thing. Our last drive-in service, I am particularly excited about this one, because we are going to have John Tommy Oaks here with us, and it'll be just like the previous weeks. We'll have parking attendants who are parking you to hopefully help people be able to park and be able to still see. And we are going to live stream it. Our technology has gotten a little better, and we're able to do this with more consistency. And yeah, it takes more people now, but it works, and it works well. So even if you're not comfortable coming to the drive-in yet, be a part of it on Facebook and YouTube Live, and be a part of worship. Be a part of seeing the God-given talents that John Thomas and Tommy share with us on Sunday. It's a great thing to be able to be together and worship. All right. So the first thing we usually do on a Wednesday night is something I want to continue right now. Since we're starting Wednesday nights live, I want us to do prayer requests live. So if you got a prayer request, go ahead and type those in here. Peyton has a praise, actually, right? Okay. So Peyton's praise is for Melinda Jennings. If you don't know Melinda, she's actually a neighbor of George and Rita's, and she has gotten a good report on some tests she had run in Florida. So that's a praise. We're thankful for the good news that Melinda Jennings got. Any other prayer requests from Facebook? Okay, yeah, keep my grandmother Wanda Laws in your prayers. She's doing well, but She's in a nursing home, and none of us have been able to visit. So that has been difficult, and just definitely keep her in your prayers. Peyton has another. Wanda Akers, yeah. Keep Wanda in your prayers. Passing of Dan, all of us haven't been able to visit and love and hug like we'd want to, which leads me to another prayer request. Irvin Myers, his family, keep Irvin's family in your prayers. The Karen Simmons family is just one that Carol put on here. So be in prayer for them. He was a member here. Okay. Travel Mercies for George and Retha. They're going to the beach on Friday. So be praying for George and Retha. They're going to South Carolina. Right, Peyton? Terry Johnson. Be in prayer for Terry. Last I knew he was, but he might be home now. You know, Terry, you're the one who. All right, I'm jotting things down as I go because I know I won't be able to find it again in the chat. All right. Any other prayer requests or praises? All right. So, what I'll do, let's pray over these requests together before we get our night started. Okay, but I'm going to. So, Terry Johnson's at home now, but still needing prayers. Okay, so my Aunt Tammy talked to Wanda Akers a few days ago. Doing well. Oh, Angie would like to lift up the elders and deacons who are meeting every week here at Hampton Christian to make decisions. A lot of people tell me that, but he's very weak. Okay. Debbie Williams shared that her best friend's grandson is in Florida, and he's only 6 years old. Can't keep food down, so we'll definitely keep that question on. Well, I don't know if you guys are realizing this, but like we're not. I know we're not able to be together, but it's so cool to be able to share these prayer requests in this way. I know you guys can't see down there, but I can see everything there. Still able to share. Okay. Now that we've got all the requests here, let me just take some time, and even if I don't mention every request by name, let's pray over the little list that we came up with tonight and just pray God's blessings over. Heavenly Father God, we love you. We trust you. And we know that you are in control, God. And we know that your timing is nothing short. God, be with all the people we had on the prayer list that need you in mighty ways. Allow them to see you at work in their lives and just allow them to, you are the constant, every one of us, provide our day. Lord, we love you. We thank you so much for everything you do for us. All in the name of Jesus. Pray together. Hey there, LD. So here is what we will do to get us started. The message tonight is nothing profound. It's nothing that you've probably not heard before, but I think it's important for us, especially in the time we find ourselves in right now. And we're going to be digging through a passage in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, but we're not going to get there just yet. I'm going to ask you a little bit of a question. So right now, what you're going to see pop up on the screen is a question. And there already. Isn't that cool? So the question is, what is a time in your life where you saw the Lord work something out for you that was amazing, but it was not in the timing that you had hoped? So while we leave that question up there for you to think about that for a minute and maybe even share as you're thinking through this, let me tell you a story in my life where I could think about this. It's actually kind of multiple stories. I'll just share it in this way. For me, I have been very spoiled by our instantaneous nature, our culture. If I decide I want pizza rolls, I could take some pizza rolls out, put them on a plate, put them in the microwave, and I can have those pizza rolls in minutes, if not seconds. And if that's what I wanted, I'm totally satisfied in that moment. It didn't take very long. And here's another thought I had. If I want to show somebody something funny that maybe I saw on the internet or that I really enjoyed that I found, I can most likely pull up my phone, find that thing, and share it with whoever. Peyton and James both can attest that if they're around me, there's usually something like, look what I found. And I really quickly show them this goofy video that I found, and then we laugh about it for a while. But that kind of stuff has spoiled me. I want things done in a quick and timely manner. So when I was in college, I stumbled across this scripture that rocked me a little bit. And it's just Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. And it's such a simple verse, but I'm going to read that and I'm going to talk for a second. There was a time for everything, season for every activity under the heaven. This is Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. And I was okay with that the first time I read it, and I was more and more discontent each time I read it. And you're probably sitting there thinking, what in the world are you talking about, Jeremiah? Well, I was sure that college is where I was supposed to be. But why was it happening in this timing? Why was it best for the timing of everything to work out the way it did? I know a lot of you have heard me talk about this, but like my associate's degree, it took 2.5 years, or it took 3 years for me to do a 3-year degree. Feed actually bottomed out. Okay, never mind. Came back. Sorry about that. I saw the indicator light change. I spent 3.5 years working on something that should have taken 2. Well, then after that, I decided to continue on onto my bachelor's degree. So at 22, I was going back in a dorm room with a bunch of college freshmen who had just gotten their first taste of freedom. They weren't in their parents' house anymore, so they were staying up till 1 or 2 in the morning, just being loud and obnoxious, and I was struggling through this, and it fueled some uncertainty and the timing of the way things worked out. And I was getting more and more discontent because I could see the people that I went to high school with that had already finished their degrees and they were getting married and their families were growing. And I caught myself looking up to heaven and saying, I don't understand your timing in this. I don't get it. And I was certain that I was in the right place, doing the right thing, I needed to be doing it, but I was so discontent. It took longer than I wanted it to. However, now I can look back and see more clearly God knew exactly what he was doing. I can now see that I may not have even been with my wife, Allison, if things hadn't worked out the way they had. I might not be the church right now. If things hadn't worked out in the timing that it did, it kind of opens up this whole new perspective for you. And God knows each and everything in the time we need to be doing. And that's hard for us. Shame on us. We want it to be our way or the highway. But God, on a number of occasions, we find scripture where he knows better. He knows the time, he understands the time, and he does better with it. So let's look at the scripture I was talking about again, but let's include the entire scripture this time. So we're going to start in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and we'll read through. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. Then there's a list of activities that or examples that happen in Ecclesiastes chapter 2 through 8. But now I'm going to skip to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 9. So in verse 9, it continues by saying, What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the heart, in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each one of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift from God. And I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing can be taken from it. God does it that people will. And there are three takeaways here. There's nothing amazing. It's just, this is one of those texts that kind of preaches itself. And the first takeaway I have is that God makes things beautiful in its time. And who knows what its time is other than the Creator, the one who created every single thing. He knows the appropriate time. He makes those. And we have a hard time with it. We want things to be beautiful, as our scripture says, in our time. But let me give you an additional perspective here. In Psalm 147, verse 5, it writes, "Great is our Lord and the abundant strength. He is understanding." The reason that God makes everything beautiful in its time is because He can see the big picture. He can see way beyond what I can. He can see beyond what you and I can understand. He's directing our steps and leading us to the place that will bring Him glory. Not to ourselves. And if we allow Him to do that, He's going to do incredible things for us. He's going to make things in our life beautiful in the right time. So simply put, trust God making your scenario beautiful. Not a one of us can fathom what God has done from beginning to end, as our scripture says. But we can trust working things out, make them beautiful. Now our second take. Finding satisfaction, toil, the gift from God. We don't like the idea of this word toil. We don't like the idea of working extremely hard to sometimes discover no immediate happiness from our hard work. And we don't like the idea of a struggle that is not instantaneously presented with some solution. So if we come up with this struggle in our lives, we struggle. We have this tension. We don't like that. Yet this scripture and many more like it point to the fact that our God is not presenting us a scenario where satisfaction is an impossibility. He's presenting us with a scenario where the laborers of our toil then a result that will bring happiness. And that happiness may not result in our own ideal timeline, what makes things. But Scripture tells us that over time is going to. Now, let's move on to our final take. Everything God does. You know, in the Scripture there, what I read is we just found. Everything God does. There's not a thing that can be done, add to it, nor nothing to be taken from it. God does this so that people will fear Him. Or in other words, stand in awe, one, exactly what He does. The clearest representation of the fact that everything God does will endure forever is the fact that He sent His Son here to die on a cross for us. Even when we were sinners, struggling in our sinful ways, He still, drawing near to us, died on the cross willingly. Because of what the Lord did, we have hope. Oh, hope. That endures. No one or nothing can take that hope away from me. fearing the Lord is not just running in terror every time something comes up and you don't understand it. Fearing the Lord is standing in awe of Him, following Him, understanding Him, and knowing everything God works in, continuing to guide us. So, as we end our night tonight, I'm going to say a prayer. But that prayer is specifically that we find contentment in God's time. The fact that He's going to make things beautiful. That we are able to find satisfaction from the toil and the inner struggles that we have going on. Matter of fact, that happiness we find, that's God. And because everything that God does, pray together. Dear Heavenly Father God, we thank You for this time. We've been able to dig into Your Word just a little bit, to lift up prayer requests, and to be together, even though it's not together in the same location. We've been able to be together to dig into Your Word. God, my prayer right now is that we find contentment. We trust Your timing is good, and we find satisfaction even in the time. God, we know everything that You're going to make things work out. God, help us to trust You. Trust these. This is all in the name of Jesus. All right. Thank you all so much for joining us for our Wednesday night conversation. Hope you have a good rest of your night. And I will see you on Sunday morning when John Thomas and Tommy Oaks will be here for our drive-in service. Just remember to be patient with us at parking. And if you're not willing to come and you're still wanting to stay at home, that's okay. We're going to live stream it like we did tonight. So you'll be able to see everything. So have a good night and stay safe.